All right, good morning, everybody. Welcome to lecture 13 of Quantum Mechanics 1. Before I begin, again, let me ask you, do you have class at 9?
Yes, sir.
Now you have learned to give the correct response, right? Okay. All right, so what we have talked about, right? We were talking about measurement. And I introduced this delta function, right? The Dirac delta function. And so let me just write down now. Okay, so what I'll do now is I'll give you the algorithm. Okay. So the first step is to prepare your system in some given state. Of course, one need not always be able to prepare the system in the state that you would like it to be in. Or so either you prepare or you just take the system in the given state. Right, so this is the first step. Oh, well, thank you. Excellent. Great. Then we have the next step. So the next step is we want to conduct a measurement. But before conducting the measurement, there's one very important part, which is that we let it evolve, right? We might not want to conduct the measurement immediately, right? And even if we do conduct the measurement immediately after preparation, there can still be some amount of time that elapses before we conduct the measurement, right? So during that time, what happens? It undergoes time evolution, right? So that I haven't talked about time evolution yet. I will talk about it today. So we let it evolve for some time, delta t, right? So when it evolves, what happens? So you start off with some state psi at some time zero, and you let it evolve to some state psi t. Okay, now at this point the measurement happens, right? So when you have to decide what observables you want to measure, right? And so your observable should be a Hermitian operator, right? And so you perform the measurement. Right? And what are you measuring? You measure example I gave you the other day was this Stern-Gerlach effect. If you want to measure the spin of the particle, for instance, right? One way to do that is to put it in an inhomogeneous magnetic field. So if you do this, if it's in a certain upspin, let's say it will go, the particle will be deflected upwards, otherwise it will be deflected downwards. And when it lands on the screen, right, it will land either here or here, right? It won't, because ultimately when you make an observation, you won't see a dot in both places. You'll see a dot in one place. So that will tell you, okay, the apparatus has measured the spin of the electron and found it to be the corresponding value, right? So the measurement is of what? Measurement is of some Hermitian observable, right? Of some Hermitian operator or observable slash observable. Okay, we'll call that operator O. All right. Now, what happens when you perform the measurement? The system collapses, right? So psi of t collapses. What does it collapse into? It collapses into an eigenstate of this operator O, right? And as I explained to you in earlier, you can write any state, any quantum state, in more than one way, right? So you can write any quantum state. So for instance, what is it? So you can write a quantum state in a different basis. So for instance, here I've written it in the uptown basis. Here I've written it in a different basis, plus minus basis, right? And these bases are related to each other by a unitary transformation. So you might ask, which vector does it collapse into, right? So if the eigenvector it collapses into depends on the operator that you measure. So for instance, sigma z, if you measure sigma z, these are eigenstates of sigma z, right? Up and down spin vectors. And what is sigma z? Sigma z is this matrix. So sigma z is this matrix, and what are these eigenvectors? They are 1, 0, and 0, 1, right? The components are very, very simple. So if you measure sigma z, it will collapse into an eigenstate of sigma z. But these eigenvectors, well, these vectors, they are not, this is not an eigenstate of sigma z, right? So you might ask, well, why does the state not collapse into one of these? Or can I do something to make the state collapse into one of these rather than to up or down spin? And the answer is yes, you can. The answer is that you find the operator whose eigenstate these vectors are, right? So plus and minus are not eigenstates of sigma z, right? But they are eigenstates of this operator, sigma plus minus. Okay, well, actually, small correction on my part. They are eigenstates of sigma x. I should have said that, not sigma plus minus. Because again, remember, that when you make a measurement, you have to make a measurement of a Hermitian operator or Hermitian observable. So are these Hermitian? Are these Hermitian matrices? Ashwini?
Yes, sir.
Sigma plus, is the sigma plus a Hermitian matrix?
Huh, sir.
What is a
Yeah, sir.
Is sigma plus, is this matrix here? You can see this?
Huh.
Is this a Hermitian matrix?
Yes, sir.
Is it? It is. What is it? What is the definition of a Hermitian matrix?
Dagger.
So if I take sigma plus dagger, what will that give me? What is the dagger operation? Harsh.
No.
Harsh. Okay.
Yes,
thanks.
Sir. Yes, sir.
What is the dagger operation?
Sir, transpose and conjugate of a matrix.
So if I take the transpose conjugate of this matrix, what do I get?
You get sigma plus again.
If I take transpose of this matrix, I get sigma plus again. Pakka? Transpose le lo bhai. Matrix ka transpose lena nahi aata.
No sir, no sir.
कैसे आ गए आप लोग बीटेक में पता नहीं
सर सिग्मा माइनस सर
सिग्मा माइनस ना सो दीज आर नॉट हर्मिशियन मैट्रिसेस ना सो दिस वाज माय मिस्टेक सो दिस यू नीड टू हैव अ हर्मिशियन ऑपरेटर सो द हर्मिशियन ऑपरेटर इज सिग्मा एक्स दीज आर नॉट हर्मिशियन बट सिग्मा एक्स इज हर्मिशियन ओके एंड इफ यू ask what are the eigenvalues of sigma x so let me just insert a page here so sigma x is 0 1 1 0 so what are the eigenstates of this you can find the eigenstates easily they are just plus and minus you can confirm that what is the plus state is 1 1 right so if you multiply it by sigma x you will get 1 1 what is the minus state it's 0 it's 1 minus 1 if you multiply it by this you will get minus 1 1 So this, the plus state is eigenvalue plus one, the minus state has eigenvalue minus one, right? Because we have just switched these two components. So if you want to measure, if you measure sigma x, the x component of the angular momentum, then what will happen? The system will collapse either into the plus state or the minus state. Okay. Is everybody like? Is this making sense? Are you following this? And again, unless you actually work things out on your own, it will not ultimately make any sense. Okay. So then I explained this whole discrete and continuous thing. I've talked a lot about that, so I guess I won't keep talking about that endlessly. And so again, when we make a measurement of this system, which is in a of this continuous system like this, so we measure the operator x. What will happen? It will collapse into the eigenstate ket x. What does that mean? What is the meaning of this eigenstate ket x? It means that when I look at the system, I find that the particle is localized. At the location x, matlab I found it to be here at this point. That's the meaning of this state ket x. Now, so psi of t collapses into an eigenstate of this operator O, and the result of the measurement. Right, meaning that you get some number from the measurement is the eigenvalue. Of that state. So these are the four steps in the measurement process. So here you have evolution, then you have measurement, and then you have collapse. And then you could complete this, let's say, by letting it continue to evolve. So again, let's look at a different measurement. Let's say that I want to ask what is the momentum of this particle. I am in an infinite potential well. Okay. And I want to measure the momentum, not the position. And before measuring the momentum, actually, let me tell you what the X operator is in the continuous case. In the continuous case, this X operator will be, you can write it as, where is it? You can write X hat as, we want to write it as a matrix, remember? So there should be two components. So we'll write it as X minus X hat, sorry, X minus X prime times X. So what does this do when you act on some state? When you act on some state, right? So when I act on some state psi, okay? And I should call this, actually, I should call this X prime hat. When I act on some state psi, what does this do? This gives me delta X minus X hat. And what is psi? So psi I can write as, psi of X. Okay, one second, let me. Be careful here. With these infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces, one has to be a bit careful. Let me just go back to the discrete case and make sure that I gave you the correct expression. Delta X over X I. So here, X hat is equal to I times delta ij, right? And if I act on this with that state, okay. Okay, so I will come back to this at a later point in time. I don't want to confuse either yourself, you or me. So let's talk about measuring momentum. Right, instead of measuring position, what do we get? Now what is the momentum operator? Minus IH bar d by dx, okay? And let's say that we have some state psi, and we want to ask, and so we can write this state as psi of x, like this, dx, right? So we want to ask, can I, what are the eigenstates of the momentum operator? Right? So this is the eigenvalue equation for the momentum operator, right? So this implies that minus IH bar d by dx of, so I'll write here psi x prime, because I'm using this d by dx here, so I'll write this. Okay. So now what I can do is I can take this derivative inside the integral. Right? And I say psi of x prime dx, x prime dx prime. Right? And we have this quantity. Now, what is this quantity? Well, we want this to be equal to p times phi, right? So this has to be equal to some number p multiplied by psi of x prime, like this, right? So we have an equation whose two sides are given as follows. This is the LHS, this is the RHS. Okay? So if you compare these two sides, you see that the integrand has to be equal, right? So you get minus h bar d psi x prime by dx is equal to p psi x prime, right? Like this. And what is the solution of this expression? The solution of this expression is that psi of x prime can be written as delta x minus x prime e to the power of I kx, where k is equal to p by h bar. Why is this delta function there? Delta function is there because, let me just remove this delta. Let me just write this as. Psi of x is equal to e to the I kx. So there can be some ambiguity about when you take this kind of a derivative. And what sort of indices you should use. So I'm just going to use, I'm going to be very mathematically very sloppy. And
I have a small clarification. Ket psi, you wrote ket psi equals psi ket x dx, right, sir? So ket x is the yes.
Right.
So ket x is the position basis, is it, sir?
That's right. Yeah.
And so basically psi x dx basically plays the role of the coefficients in the discrete.
That's right.
Okay.
Right. Absolutely. Right.
Sir.
Yes.
Can you please go on to the last page, sir?
Sure.
In this page, sir, you wrote a p vector, p operator operating on psi gives me p psi. Here, p is the number, right? P will get a number, right?
P is a number, that's right. Yes. P is the eigenvalue.
So then what is the difference between doing this and taking inner product and expectation value of p? What is the difference between these two?
Because so inner product can be taken. So inner product is between any two states like this. Let's say this is inner product.
Yes.
Then you can also calculate the matrix element of some operator. This is the matrix element. Or just the, this is also an inner product.
Yes.
And if you say that the two states are the same, then you call this an expectation value. Okay.
Yes, sir, but my question is, what is the difference between this expectation value and operator theta acting on the state psi giving me a number theta? What is this theta and expectation value of theta? Are they different?
Right. Okay. So let's say that I have some operator which acts on some state psi and gives me some number. Right?
Yes. What is the difference between this?
Now, one second. Hold on. I'm answering. One second. Now let me take the expectation value of operator O in the state psi. Okay. This is the expectation value, right? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Right. And so on the what I'm doing is I'm just contracting with the with this bra vector on the left hand side.
Yes.
So I have to put a bra vector on the left hand side over here also. Right?
Yes.
Now lambda is just a number, so I can write this as lambda. Right?
Yes.
And so assuming these states are normalized, what is this equal to?
Lambda.
It's just lambda.
So then why are we taking doing the inner product? We can just actually take a state psi and just operate it with an operator and get a
value. So that's lambda. What I'm trying to tell you, na? That the expectation value of an operator in an eigenstate is the same as the eigenvalue.
Okay, sir. Yes, yes.
Right? So when the operator collapses into an eigenstate, when your state collapses into an eigenstate of an operator, you get a number. That number is the eigenvalue, but that's also the expectation value of that operator.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
So now what do my eigenstates of momentum look like? My eigenstates of momentum, I can write them either in terms of P or in terms of K. So these two are one and the same thing, right? E to the IKX, get x dx. This is an eigenstate of momentum operator. What is the eigenvalue? The eigenvalue is, right, P is equal to h bar k. And yeah, h bar k. And I hope you all remember where you get this expression from. This expression comes from the fact that k is equal to 2 pi by lambda. H bar is equal to h by 2 pi. So h bar k is equal to h by lambda. And that's equal to p. Okay. Now, this state, right? So is this state localized around any position value? It's not, right? So you see, as an so this complex exponential might make it a little bit difficult for you to visualize what's going on here. So instead of writing it like this, let me write a different state, which is related to this. Okay. Let me write the state as a superposition of P and minus P. Okay. So what will this be? And divided by 2. This will just be exponent ikx plus exponent minus ikx by 2 x dx. Okay. What is it? This is cosine ikx get x dx. Oh, sorry, cosine kx, not ikx, cosine. Right? Now you can visualize this, right? So if this is equal to x is equal to 0, x is equal to L. What is this cosine kx? Cosine kx will just be, well, it depends on what the value of k is, right? So let's say that k is equal to k1. Okay. k1 being the smallest value of the momentum, that is for the because you remember that momenta are quantized in the infinite potential well, right? So what are the what are the quantum numbers? The momenta is n pi, right? So k of n is equal to n pi x over l. So k1 is equal to pi by l, right? So if we plot the cosine here, what will it look like? It will look like this. It will start here, and it will go here, right? So this is cosine pi x by l, right? For zero, for x is equal to zero, it's equal to one. For x is equal to l, it's equal to cosine pi, which is minus one. Right? So this is a state which is an eigenstate of momentum. Well, no, it's not an sorry, it's not an eigenstate of momentum, but it's a superposition of two eigenstates. It corresponds to a superposition of a momentum state, which is corresponds to plus p, right? Let's say a particle moving towards the right and a particle moving towards the left. I've taken the superposition just so I can get something which gives me a real coefficient. But you don't have to take a real coefficient. You can also just look at this, right? If I just look at the if I just look at this eigenstate e to the ikx dx, right? Well, e to the ikx, so this has a real part cosine kx and a imaginary part sine kx get x dx, right? So if I want to look at the full wave function, right, if I want to look at this wave function, what it looks like, I have to make a plot of both the complex value and the real value. So the real part is my cosine part, right? This is my cosine. And my complex part of my wave function will look like the sine, right? In either case, what is the property of this state? This state is a superposition of all the position eigenstates. So if you look at this state and you ask the question, what is the position of the particle? The particle is not localized at any one point, na? What does that mean? That means it has a probability. So when you calculate the probability of where the particle lies, the probability is distributed along the entire axis, right? Along x is equal to along the entire interval, right? So do you follow what I'm saying? That this is the difference between a state which is localized and one which is not localized. So what is a localized state? Right. Localized means that, let's say you have some, this is psi of x and this is x, or I'll talk about the probability, that's better, psi of x squared. A localized state means that my probability psi of x squared looks like this. Right? It is sharply peaked around some given value of my variable x. So when I measure the position of the particle and the system is in this state, what will I get? I will get x naught, right? I mean, with the almost all the measurements will give me something near x naught, right? But if I have a state whose probability looks like this, something like this, let's say, okay? This is not a localized state. Okay, there's some gap. So this is not a localized state, right? This I would refer to as a delocalized or a non-local state. I would say that the state is spread out, right? Because now the probability of finding the particle is spread out over all these different regions. Right? This is just an example. You can work with this kind of a distribution only, and just consider two different shapes. Right? So if you compare these two probability distributions, which one would you say is more localized than the other? Right? So let me call this P1X, let me call this P2X. Which one is more localized than the other one? Which one has greater uncertainty in the P1X, right? So P1X is more localized. Meaning that also means that it has less uncertainty. Right? So what is this so what does this tell me? This tells me that if I look at an eigenstate of momentum, right? So this is an eigenstate of momentum, right? This is an eigenstate of momentum. Okay. And this eigenstate is spread out, no? Because you can see the components are not in any one place, right? They're spread out. On the other hand, if I look at an eigenstate of position, right? This is ket x. This is an eigenstate of position, right? So what can you say about eigenstates of momenta versus eigenstates of position? Can you like look at this picture? Like if I just told you that, look, these are eigenstates of momenta, this green and the blue one, they are the different components. One is the real component, let's say, and one is the imaginary component. Okay. And then this is the position eigenstate. What if you didn't know anything about quantum mechanics, but you knew what probability distribution is, what would you say about this eigenstate versus the momentum eigenstate? Vishnu, what observation would one be able to make just by looking at this picture without knowing anything about quantum mechanics?
So it's meaning, at the same time, we cannot get a position.
No. Again, you are bringing in your prior knowledge, right? So I don't want you to bring in your prior knowledge into looking at this. Don't think of this as position and momentum. Just think of this as some A state and this B state.
Okay.
Yeah. Shubham, Shubham? Yes, sir. Okay. Do you understand what I'm trying to ask? Just look at this state and this state. What is the difference between these two states?
No idea.
At least you are honest. Okay.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Huh?
Sir, is it one is at a certain position and one is spread out?
One is spread out. That's exactly the point, right, that I'm making. One is completely localized in position. The other is completely spread out in position.
Okay.
Right. So, the position eigenstate is completely localized. But localized where? Localized with respect to X in the position space. Right? Momentum eigenstate is completely maximally spread out. Spread out in position space. This is important, okay? What this tells you, this is also another statement of the uncertainty principle. Why? Because it means that when I try to measure the position with accuracy, right? If I try to measure the position so that I reduce delta x, what does that mean? That means that I have a state like this, which is very localized in position, right? But that same state, if I ask what is the momentum of that state, the momentum of that state is something that is completely spread out. So if I measure position very accurately, momentum I cannot measure accurately. Okay. Now let me look at the reverse situation. So let me again write the momentum eigenstate. So the momentum eigenstate is e to the ikx get x dx. Okay. Now, this is a position eigenstate. Right? And this is a momentum eigenstate. Right? Can I invert this relationship between these two? Can I write X as some superposition of momentum eigenstates? Is that possible? Can I do this?
Yes, sir.
I should be able to do it, no? Because this is just a linear transformation. So I should be able to invert the linear transformation. Right? And I can do it. And it will look something like this. It will look like e to the minus ikx pdp. Okay. And you actually have to put some factors of 1 by root 2 pi here. So let me show you how that this is in fact an identity. Okay, let me show you why this is an identity. So my claim is that the position eigenstate can be written in this way in terms of the momentum eigenstate. And I already know right? So this is known. I know this. This is my claim. So if I want to check this claim, what do? I take this expression for the momentum eigenstate and I substitute it in here. So substitute B in A. Okay. So I substitute the expression for ket vector k into the expression for ket vector x. What do I get? I get e to the minus I kx. Now I have to substitute this expression for k. Right? What should I write down? What will be in the that expression? How should I write this down? Aarti, can you tell me? Should I just write down e to the I kx? Aarti?
Yes, sir.
I said Aarti, but you heard Bharti. That's okay. Bharti, you can also answer. Should I just write down e to the I kx ket x like this? When I substitute this expression in here? Bharti?
Yes, sir, but ye.
Bataiye.
Is that zero, na?
Kya, what is zero? Haan, nahi, wo zero nahi. Abhi dekhiye. Yahan pe main x likh sakta hoon? x नहीं लिख सकता. देखिए यहां पे मुझे दूसरा वेरिएबल लिखना पड़ेगा, x प्राइम लिखना पड़ेगा.
यस सर.
आप समझ रही हैं क्यों?
बिकॉज़ वो क्लेम वाला है ना.
हाँ बोलिए.
वो क्लेम वाला है ना, दूसरा वाला.
हाँ क्लेम वाले में x यूज्ड है ना.
हाँ, then
तो आप फिर से नहीं यूज कर सकते.
हाँ यस.
ठीक है ना.
हाँ यस सर.
तो x is already used in this expression, so I can't use here, I can't use again x, right? So in this expression here, k here x is a dummy variable. This is what is known as a dummy variable. So this becomes my k vector, k eigenvector k. And then this whole thing integrated over dk like this. So this becomes my expression. Okay? Now, I have 1 by 2 pi e to the ik. Now, if you look at this expression, I can write this as ik x prime minus x. No? X prime minus x, I'll write dk, and then dx prime x prime. Okay? Is everybody following this step here? If you are not following this step, you please tell me. I'll stop and I'll go back and I'll go repeat again.
Sir, is there a double integral?
Yeah, this is a double integral. No, I'm just not writing the double integral sign. You want me to write that? Fine, I'll do that. Is it better? I'm sorry, like you know, like I don't like when you reach a certain level, you forget that these are the simple things which confuse you when you're first learning the subject. So I'll be more careful about this. This is a double integral lesson. Right? Now I'm going to tell you something. So what I'll do is I'll write the integral as x prime outside and the integral with k inside. So on the outside, I'll write ket x prime dx prime. This is my outer integral. And my inner integral, I'll write as e to the I kx minus x prime divided by 2 pi dk. Right? So I'll perform this integration first. So this is dk, not dx. So can anybody tell me what this should be equal to? So first of all, I know that this whole expression, this should give me ket x, no? This has to be equal to ket x, right? Now I have ket x prime dx prime, and I'm integrating over x prime. So what should this integral turn out to be? What should it be?
So delta.
It has to be the delta function, no? It has to be the delta function. If it's not the delta function, then I'm in trouble. Right? So if this is the delta function, then the left-hand side just becomes integral over x prime, delta x minus x prime dx prime. And what is this? This is just x. Because when I integrate over x prime, what do? I just set x prime equal to x, because that is the only value for which this function is non-zero. Right? So if this quantity is equal to the delta function, then this statement is correct. Right. Now it turns out that this quantity is the delta function. Okay, it is the delta function. So you can write delta x minus x prime as 1/2 pi. root 1 by 2 pi integral from minus infinity to infinity e to the ik x minus x prime dk. This is one definition of the delta function, right? As I have told you before, this delta function is a distribution, and so it doesn't have any one expression. You can write it in many different forms. This is one of the forms of the Dirac delta function. Right? And now when you look at this, you might think, like, this will not make sense to you. Like, why is this the case? Right? Why is this the case? Ho kya raha hai? Let me go back a few classes to when we talked about orthogonality of the our wave function. You remember that? When we did that inner product psi m psi n. We had done that, no? What is that? Okay. I got disconnected. Can everybody hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you remember when we did this? This was back, well, not too long ago, 1 week ago. We talked about orthogonality of psi m and psi n, right? Right. And how did we do that? Do this orthogonality? We took the inner product of these two quantities, which means we multiplied them by each other and integrated over x, right? And when we integrated over x, what did we get? We got these different terms, right? And we found that one term is zero always, the m plus n term. This is always zero. And what about the m minus n term? the m minus n term we found is zero when m is equal to n, right? By definition, because m is equal to n, so m minus n is zero. But when m is not equal to n, then what happens? Oh, sorry, my mistake. When m is not equal to n, then it's zero. But when m is equal to n, then what happens? Because in the denominator also, you get a 1 by m minus n, no? Right? And then you saw that you have to take this limiting procedure. And when you do this limiting procedure, then you get this expression, right? You get 0 or 1 if m is not equal to n or if m is equal to n, right? Now, you can look at this expression in a different way. This is pi m, m pi l, this is n pi l, right? So what is m pi l? M pi l is km, right? N pi l is kn. Let me call this k and let me call this k prime. So this I can also write as delta k k prime, right? And you see, this is very similar, almost, well, it's exactly the same, in fact, as this expression, right? Because this expression has two parts, right? One is the real part, one is the imaginary part. Let me write out the real part first. What is the real part? Cosine kx times cosine kx prime dk. And then you have the imaginary part. What is that? That is sine kx. There's going to be a negative sign. And sine kx prime dk. Right? So when you do these integrals, and doing these integrals is a little bit tricky. It's not the same as the previous case, because here k becomes a continuous parameter. X and x prime are continuous parameters. They are not integers. But the result is the same. You get delta x minus x prime. Okay, so this I will continue talking about next time. But I hope that I have given you some idea of what measurement and collapse means, and then what it means to make a measurement of, let's say, the position versus the momentum, right? So we'll continue talking about all of these things. But on Monday, you will have your quiz, and the quiz will be, let's say, everything up till the measurement part, okay? So I won't ask you questions about measurement and collapse, but I can ask you any other question about operators, Hermitian operators, unitary operators, eigenstates, eigenvectors, uncertainty, any of the questions which I've given you on the homework assignment and so on. Okay. Any questions?
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Sir,
in the derivation of the position wave function, so can you go back to that slide? Today, that momentum operator.
Momentum operator. The eigenstate of the momentum, you mean?
Yes, sir. We derived that. Sir, a little bit.
This? This expression?
Yes, just a complex number. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah,
psi of x is a complex number, right?
Sure.
It's a coefficient.
Yeah, this is a complex number, right?
Sir, so if you are taking the derivative, we are actually taking the derivative of ket x or psi of x.
You're taking the derivative of what, sorry?
Ket x or psi of x.
You're taking derivative of psi of x.
But sir, psi of x is a constant, right?
No, psi of x is a function of x, huh? I mean, for a particular value of x, it's a constant, right?
Okay.
But as you change x, psi of x changes, no?
No, sorry, I'm just confused.
Psi of x, yeah.
So you have written a ket psi equal to integration sin x ket x dx. Sir, I have a problem with this expression, with expression like inner product of psi, like bra psi ket psi equal to integration sin star psi dx. So, sir, what is the basic difference between these two? Actually, I'm not getting, there is a two functions, psi x and ket psi. These are two states. And again, we are writing state.
One second. Which are the two states? Which are the two states you are referring to?
Sir, we know that bra psi ket psi equal to.
Let me do it on a fresh page. Okay, go ahead. Now tell me. Yeah.
Sir, inner product of psi equal to psi star psi dx, right?
You're asking what is this expression, right?
No, sir. I'm just clearing my doubt. This is inner product of psi equal to psi star psi dx, right? So there is two states, psi and psi star. Basically, these are two functions, psi and psi star. So we are getting this.
Yeah.
But in your expression, there is a ket psi equal to psi x, and also there is a state. Means there is a two-wave function, sir.
Ah, so one second. No, let me. This is the function. This is the state vector. Okay. This is the state.
Okay.
This is what you want to call your wave function, if you want to call it that. This is the component of that state. Right. But what you will find in most introductory books is they will call this the wave function. Right. Which is an abuse of terminology, because the actual, the full wave function on the full state is this quantity.
Yes.
Ashutosh?
No, sir, actually, I'm still confused. Sir, there is a probability term, when we are interacting with do.
One second. Now, what is the bra psi? Tell me, how will I write bra psi?
Psi star,
then
dx,
nothing else,
sir. I do not know, so I am asking. Yeah,
bhai, I have to take the, what is it, this is the Hermitian adjoint of psi, na, of ket psi.
Yes, sir.
So if I take the Hermitian adjoint of this quantity, what will I get?
So there will be bra x dA.
Right?
Yes, sir. But I am.
No, I mean, is this fine so far? Just tell me this.
Okay, sir.
Is it? Yeah, yeah, theek hai.
No, sir. Actually, I have a problem in this. There are
two states. One second, please. As an expression, this is okay or not okay?
Okay, sir.
ठीक है. अच्छा, now one second. And let me put x prime here. ठीक है.
Okay, sir.
ठीक है ना?
Yes,
I can call it anything I want. I'm calling it x prime. This is a dummy variable. Why is it a dummy variable? Because it doesn't appear in the expression on the left, no? It's a zoom mein problem aa gaya yaar. Hello. Right. Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So this is a dummy variable, right? Okay.
Yes,
because
sir.
It doesn't appear on the left side. ठीक है. नाउ लेट मी टेक साई साई ओके दिस एक्सप्रेशन और तुम्हारी जो डाउट है आई विल फुली कुक ओके लुक एट दैट बट फर्स्ट लेट मी जस्ट डू दिस. ये क्या व्हाट विल दिस बिकम? दिस विल बिकम अ डबल इंटीग्रल.
यस सर.
ठीक है ना.
ओके
साई स्टार एक्स प्राइम साई एक्स एंड देन कैट ब्रा एक्स प्राइम कैट एक्स. ठीक है.
ओके
व्हाट इज दिस क्वांटिटी?
One.
What is the inner product of two different eigenstates?
Zero.
Or
how? If they are orthogonal, they are zero. If they are same state.
So how do I express? How do I write that if that or thing? How do I write it as one expression mathematically?
Delta is delta. Yeah, chronical delta.
Chronical, no, Dirac delta. Because this is a continuous parameter, right? Yeah.
Yes.
ठीक है ना.
ओके सर.
नाउ आई परफॉर्म द इंटीग्रल ओवर एक्स प्राइम. व्हाट डू आई गेट? आई कैन टेक द इंटीग्रल ओवर एक्स प्राइम और ओवर एक्स विच एवर इट डजंट मैटर. आई कैन डू इट इन ईदर ऑर्डर. लेट मी परफॉर्म द इंटीग्रल ओवर एक्स प्राइम. व्हाट डज दिस गिव मी?
साइन स्टार एक्स डीएक्स.
साइन स्टार
एक्स डीएक्स.
वाई डीएक्स?
बिकॉज व्हेन एक्स प्राइम इक्वल टू एक्स दिस विल बी
दिस इज द इंटीग्रेशन वेरिएबल ना.
यस सर.
इफ यू इंटीग्रेट ओवर दिस वेरिएबल विल इट अपीयर इन द फाइनल एक्सप्रेशन?
After integration, this will not
apply. If I take sine of x dx, integral yes. Sine of x dx, what is the answer?
Cos minus cos x.
Is it equal to minus cos x dx?
No, sir.
Okay.
So that will come in psi star, right?
Psi star x.
X.
So what will you be left with? You'll be left with dx psi x star, right?
Yes.
And this will be one if the state is normalized.
Okay.
अब बताइए आपकी exact doubt क्या थी and have I cleared up any doubt or not?
It's clear little bit. Actually, this is verified what I was asking. But the thing is the state after the wave function. So I was not getting exactly why we are writing like this.
Which one? Where?
Psi x and next to that ket x.
Ket x. So this is the whole thing I've been trying to explain for the past 4 or 5 classes, na?
Yes, sir.
Ki this is the basis vector and this is the component.
Sir.
Bhai, if you take a vector like this, theek hai?
Okay.
You write it like this. These are the basis vectors, right? E hat. Basis vector hai na? Ashutosh?
May you please write this on a different side? There is some template of talking right on Zoom.
Huh?
That is not visible where you are writing.
Oh, that's not visible. Okay, yeah. I didn't know that. Sorry. This is a basis vector, na?
Yes, sir.
And I is the index, which labels the different basis vectors.
Yes, sir.
This also I will write as ket psi only. This is for a discrete wave function. This is for a continuous wave function.
Okay, so here ket x is something basis vector, right?
Exactly.
So I mean, ket x is not a wave function. This is only a basis.
No, ket x is also a wave function. Bhai, any vector is just a vector, na? It can be a basis vector in a certain basis. This is the thing about vector spaces, na? You have some basis uv, let's say, right? And then you have some vectors ab. You can write this expression, let's say, right?
Yes, sir.
But then can I invert this expression? Can I write u and v in terms of a and b?
Yes, sir.
I can do that, no?
Yes, sir.
Some function of ab. So is this a basis vector here, or is it not a basis vector?
Sir, in U vector there will be a basis vector be C and B.
So A and B,
A and B.
So all vectors are just vectors. This is a vector. This is a vector. If I make a particular choice of basis, so this is my basis here, UV. Here, what is my basis? Here, my basis is AB.
Okay, yes, sir. So
these states, these wave functions, they are vectors. This is a vector. This is a vector.
And psi x is also a function, right?
So psi of x is a component of that vector. Okay. Now, anyways, I'll have to stop now because there's enough. We have had gone on long enough. And the thing is, you won't understand this until you actually sit down and do the exercises that I've given you. Okay.
Okay, sir. Sure.
And okay, I will upload all the.
Sir, I have last one. Sir, I just want to clear last one. Is a vector equal to alpha into u vector, right? So u vector is a basis vector and alpha is the coefficient of u vector. So okay. In this expression, ket psi is equal to integration psi x ket x. So ket x is a basis vector and the psi x is the component of that basis vector, right? Mm-hmm. Like alpha.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I just want to clear.
Bilkul, that is all I've been trying to tell you for the past 2 weeks. All of
okay, sir. Okay, thank you.
If you understand this, then you will be halfway towards understanding quantum mechanics.
So okay. Psi x dx, that would be the coefficient, not exactly that, to be more precise.
Well, no, the dx part is only needed because you are integrate. You are summing over a continuous variable, na?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. The dx part is simply what is known as technically the measure.
Okay. Okay.
Right?
Hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Anything else?
No, sir. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Then I'll see you guys on Monday. And remember that our quiz will include everything except measurement and collapse. Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Uh-huh.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.